You need good agronomic practices. You need your resources to be managed effectively. So you became twin pillar. And then we realized that even if you have these two pillars, you will not be able to address the problems of livelihood of the smallholder farmers under socio-economic aspects are addressed. So you need socio-economic research also embedded into your program. Globally, it has been demonstrated that technology capital is strongly correlated with agricultural total factor productivity growth. And those nations which have innovation and have scaled them up and ensured that they are available to the end user, they have made faster progress. So, what are the strategies for natural resource management? Strategies are that we will have to now have holistic research around farming system. Farmer is not dependent only on one crop. If he can grow fish on the farm, he will grow fish. If he can grow trees, then he will go for agroforestry. If he can grow fruit, he will go for horticulture. And if he can diversify to go for secondary and specialty agriculture as a protected cultivation, he will like to go in that direction. But then you need this knowledge to be provided to him. We need to have more precision water and nutrient management. We have been exploiting these resources without any specific consideration. Even today, you go to Punjab or Haryana, farmers adopt flood irrigation. And when he gets water from canal, he is not worried. He goes and sleeps after opening the canal, whether four other neighbor's fields are also flooded. So water is free. Government has given water free. Water is not price. When a bottle of water is 10 rupees, you don't waste one drop of water. When the chief minister asked me, how can we get rid of rice wheat cultivation and excessive use of water, I said, you ban flooding. You go for micro-irrigation. You go for drip irrigation, sprinkler irrigation. There are options, but then I can't do it because I will lose my votes. So there are issues, but that doesn't mean there are no options. These options are available, and we have to continue struggling, convincing the policymaker to adopt these options. Scientific land use, Indira Gandhi canal to Rajasthan, and we permitted them to grow wheat, rice and cotton, whereas we should have allowed them to go for what they call a silvipastoral approach, in which you have trees, you have grasses and you have animals, which were more sustainable. But now there is problem of flooding, there is problem of salinity, and farmers don't know what to do. So when I suggested to the chief minister of Rajasthan that can't you do this? He said, well, we have already permitted, we can't do it. Then I said, what about Narmada Canal? Because Narmada Canal 4 years ago was coming to Rajasthan. So I said, at least in that command area, you can have this ban on the flood irrigation. And that is the only example today in the country where they have adopted the principle of no flood irrigation, but micro irrigation, and they have covered double the area from the same water, which otherwise they never used. So, we have problems, but we have solutions. We need scaling of innovation, conservation agriculture. Every agronomist would at one time when we were students would not believe that you can have after rice next crop without cultivating fields. Clean cultivation, the field must be plowed immediately after harvesting, and then there will be all wind erosion, and then there will be all kinds of soil erosion. And in that respect, we notice that conservation agriculture is one of the good alternatives. In Latin America, it is all conservation agriculture. In US, no cultivation of fields after harvesting of maize or after harvesting of soybean, and they have a rotation of sustainable rotation of one cereal and one first crop, soybean and maize. One year in the same field, soybean, the same field, next year is made. And direct seeding of the next crop. So you have such options available, but it took us almost 50 years to appreciate these new approaches. Climate smart agriculture we need now, I will explain it, and the strengthening of partnership and capacity. So I have talked already scientific land use planning. Now when you want to do scientific land use planning, look at, I have lot of institutions in the Indian Council of Agriculture Research, and one institute is known as Soil Survey and Land Use Planning. So I had to tell those guys that you change your name of the institute. You have been so far only doing soil survey. You have not done any scientific land use planning, because the maps we have done good work. All districts for all kinds of water, salinity, iron, zinc deficiency, boron, whatnot. You have maps for every district, but those maps are at 1:25,000 scale. When you want to do the planning at the micro level, then you need 1:10,000 scale of. So you just couldn't do it, though you have done so much over the last more than 100 years of soil survey. And now we are talking of issuing soil health card so that farmer can use nutrients according to the need of that particular field. But what kind of analysis and what kind of data is provided to farmer and how he is using is a big question to be understood. We had organized in 2015 the issue of soil health, because my predecessor, Dr. Rundhava, a soil scientist, used to say that Indian soils are more hungry than thirsty. Pani to chahiye sabko, water is critical for crop, but soil health is also important for good crop. And we have depleted soil health beyond a level which is now being considered as irreversible. The organic matter content. Organic matter content we are not. So this says that you must mainstream organic recycling, create an enabling environment for fertilizer use efficiency. I will also mention about it. Our efficiency is quite low, though we are using good amount of fertilizer, and we must ensure the soil degradation, and we must go in for site-specific nutrient management by using the methods and tools that are available for effective fertilizer use. What kind of recycling? The only source of recycling is the dung, animal dung. But you go anywhere, you Western UP, the Indo-Gangetic Plain, which is the bound, the food bound for India, Punjab, Haryana, this site is common. And all houses, all ladies busy having these 1,000 cakes prepared and drying them so that they can use these for fuel. Now they are right, because there is no other way, because no other source of fuel. So I can't also go and tell them that no, you stop your cooking and put this powder in the fields, because field health is important, which is not understandable by common public. So you need to look into alternatives. We know you either provide bioenergy to the farmer, you provide them gas, you provide them what they call is biogas plants in the villages, which we started promoting but did not succeed, and we have to tell them that you have to have residue management so that whatever you harvest, it is recycled. There are models, Chinese model is well known, and in the community gas plants are successful, you can still use another plant to cooperate. So there are issues, but they need to be looked into, and you cannot say, oh well, let this also be not healthy, I am not worried. because I have enough food today. There are people who are now saying, we go for organic farming, forgetting about the use of nutrients and pesticides, whereas organic farming will not feed your increasing population. Your productivity would not be as high as we otherwise anticipate. And look here, we are burning rice straw. This is Punjab, figure 2000, practically no burning. Look at 2002, 2004, 2014. It is all red now. You see red picture which you see is the area which has been burned. And that's how today there is a problem of pollution. Even in the cities like Delhi and Gurgaon, it is not worth living there. And this is all being created due to burning of the rice straw, which otherwise could be effectively used. This could be used if we just take this one technology and promote it to the farmer, like turbo happy seeder, by which you can rotate it in the entire residue into the soil and can go in for less crop quite easily. There are other approaches like FX technology. Now in Michigan, they are working with our NDRI Institute in Karnal, where they have dramatically increased digestibility of cereal straw by using high pressure ammonia. And the cellulose and amyl cellulose degradation takes place quite effectively, and you can then use it as feed. And they can also make pellet of it, so the bulk can also be reduced into pellets and can be made available as feed for better digestibility. But we are not looking at these alternatives. Crop intensification, rice and wheat. But we are not thinking of growing in between a crop like moong bean, which is legume, which could not be possible before if you had not gone for planting of moong bean in extending wheat crop before their harvesting. And you see in this slide, which is there, in this one, you see that the wheat is still to be harvested, but moong bean is already growing and germinating. So you have to cut the cycle and you have to go for this kind of delay cropping. And that these are the options that are available. This way you can also increase the fertilizer, fixing ability of the soil to the level of about 30 to 40 kg nitrogen if you have grown moong bean crop just for a short season of 60 days. And save on the fertilizer use on the subsidy crop. So rice wheat, I have already told you, so just directly now using, after the rice, using this zero tear drills, directly seeding wheat, and you see here what in fact you are finding a good crop which is emerging in the direct field. We started this program between four countries, Pakistan, Nepal, Bangladesh and India. And I was leading this program on behalf of the World Bank and the International Center. And we received King Bodomin Award. This was considered to be the best eco-regional program for addressing the concern of natural resource management. Today, we have still only 2 million hectare area covered, whereas potential is of 10 million hectare. So we need to scale out such innovations which are already available. But we have to understand why they are not picking up, what are the constraints, whether technology needs refinement, or whether extension is on deep wicket, and therefore we need to provide better technical backstopping to the farmer. And we also require carbon trading policy in our country. Globally, the sea market may reach around 1 trillion market by 2020. But none of this is available to our smallholder farmers. So if they go in for conservation agriculture, Conservation agriculture means keep the soil covered also. Not let the soil be exposed. And when you do it, you are helping in reducing the greenhouse gases and you are helping in carbon sequestration. And for that, the smallholder farmers must be incentivized. But there is no compensation for environmental services to smallholder farmers in the developing country, which in fact is a matter of policy. Coming then to mineral fertilizer use. Look at China using maximum fertilizer, 45 million tons. India is not left behind, though we are almost less than half. But still 17 million compared to US 12 million and other countries are somewhere between 2 to 4 million. So we have done well in meeting our fertilizer needs. The phosphorus and potash, we are not able to produce and we are importing all of it. So we need solutions for phosphorus and potash in our country. But for nitrogen, we have been able to. But what is happening to nitrogen? When you look at, you see India using somewhere around 120-130 kg nitrogen per hectare, as against that of in China, which is more than 200 to even 300 kg. So, sometimes people say that they are using excessive nitrogen. But then, all said and done, even if they are using more, their productivity level is 5 tons. Our productivity is just less than 2 tons. Our nitrogen use efficiency is just 30%. Now, we can't waste this nitrogen once you put it in the soil. And this is a researchable issue which would require attention of young generation. We are still using broadcasting, which is not an economical and efficient method, which is not also hygienic in terms of the farmer's health, but this practice is still being adopted. And we are using granular urea because it is good for spreading. In the entire US, there is no use of granular fertilizer. It is all liquid nitrogen which is put into the soil directly by the machinery. And the efficiency by that is almost 70%. As compared to when you use this practice, your efficiency is hardly 17 to 30%. So, we need to now look at new options and you have to also think of these approaches, the leaf color chart or green seeker, or there are other precision support systems which can be adopted, but for that you have to train the youth and they should go field to field and explain to the farmer how much to be used and when to be used. So innovation is needed for precision nutrient management. You need to use nutrient expert devices which are now available. And we need to also have the engagement of youth in this process. There is another technology which is now emerging through spectroscopy. You can, using the satellite imagery, you can also judge the nutrient requirement of soil in a small area. And if that is possible, we are now already leader in space research. Why can't we do that? And when you look at this, through this mid-infrared technology using spectroscopy, you can see that in practically no difference when you have the chemical analysis on ground and when you have chemical analysis done through spectroscopy. Even soil organic carbon can be estimated and the pH level can be estimated. So you need now to advance, and for that you need human resources and best laboratories and institutions like so many, so that these issues are properly looked at. Groundwater, I told earlier, we are pulling groundwater. Every year, water table in Punjab, Haryana went down by almost 30 centimeters, 1 foot down. We are using maximum groundwater in the whole world, and for that we need to go for micro-irrigation system. We need to go for other alternatives like direct heating of pipe rather than transplanting. Transplanting requires more water. When you do direct heating, you can save water to a considerable extent. So there are options, and there is option like laser leveling. If you do laser leveling, then you can reduce water use by almost 30%. And when you go for polythene mulch, then you again reduce it by 15 to 20%. And when you go for micro irrigation, so you can reduce water by almost 50 to 60%, providing you adopt these new approaches. See this approach, direct seeding of rice. Here the direct seeding is done. Germination has started, and now you see here complete germination. So these options are available. There is also another innovation now. Nobody would have ever thought that, you know, the subsurface drip system can be used for raising rice crop. And now this is rice wheat, which is being grown in this field. What you see here, and this is using the subsurface drip system. This is the third year in the experiment is in Ludhiana, and it provides you almost 1.75 tons hectare additional yield, and it saves water by 70 centimeters, which is almost double irrigation water productivity, and with 20% less fertilizer yield. So there are options to protected cultivation. Very suitable for situations in Himachal Pradesh, where you have